This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream, which now comes with a little thing called Nebula. Entry-level components, motherboards with bare-bones features, new single-sided RAM, dual-core CPUs. The components that show up when you do a properly sorted search in Amazon don't exactly enjoy a good reputation among a lot of mainstream tech channels. Recently, the good people at Linus Tech Tips did a video building a PC with every cheapest available new component, and then compare it to a good value PC, which of course triggered many of you to tweet me the video. I have linked the video in the description so you can take a look. Now, I'm not going to comment on the fact that they use an Athlon 3000G with one stick of single channel RAM, because several of you were already pointing this out in the video comment section, and because I think the point of that video was to intentionally make an unbalanced PC, and I have already made my case in a past video where I improved their cheap PC during Linus Tech Expo last year. You really want to use dual channel when using an integrated GPU on an APU. There's also the paradoxical decision to pair it with a GT210, a GPU that is far, far worse than the pretty acceptable Vega 3 integrated within the Athlon, which I'm not super sure what was the point of that combination, but I have the feeling they just kinda forgot how good the integrated graphics of these guys can get. Which is a blessing in more than one way, because while the Athlon is not exactly the best bang for buck, it allows for two-stage builds, which are way friendlier in a budget for people in developed countries. As I explained in this video that came as a response to Linus talking about the Athlon. Wait, is this the third time I make one of these videos responding to something Linus did with an Athlon? Oh no, it is! Am I becoming one of those YouTubers? However, the overall point of conclusion from this video seems to be twofold.
Just because something is brand new off the shelf doesn't mean that it is a viable option for building a system.
Which I agree that when using entry-level stuff, one has to be very smart about these things, like using dual-channel RAM, and instead of pairing it with a weaker dedicated GPU, just lowering the resolution scale than using an integrated GPU. Who in the world is expecting to play in full settings when they buy a $50 APU? But the main conclusion of the video is what I found a bit more concerning.
You know, that's what kind of drives me crazy about this entry-level hardware as it gets branded. Really what it is, in my opinion, basically e-waste. Because you might say, well, you know, not everyone wants to put the work into putting together something secondhand, but it's not even a ton of work.
Now, I'm using Linus as an example here, because this is an argument that is very common in PC building circles. In fact, this came up during the budget PC building panel in the last LTX, which I link in the description, from which Pedro from the PC Master Race community made the point that I'm going to argue in this video. Also, a point that many of you made in that comment section. So, let's use this Linus Tech Tip video as an excuse to discuss the problems with buying used PC parts around the world. Now, I understand where many of these perceptions come from. North America and Western Europe, as well as many other developed countries, are hotbeds for fantastic used computer part deals. Channels like Us Talks Hardware are fantastic examples of how, if you use a little creativity and know-how to navigate the used market, you can get a working gaming PC for almost nothing in places like the United States. If you're confident in the used market in your country and your ability to navigate it, listen to people like him. Go find yourself a great deal and build a cheap PC. Now, let's talk about everyone else. The used part markets is kind of a mess in developing countries. Stuff that can be dirt cheap in the US can be priced up a fair deal in unexpected places, so I decided to do a bit of research. Let's assume the core components of a build similar to the one in the video but a bit smarter. The Athlon 3000G, the cheapest motherboard that allows overclocking in each territory, and the cheapest available dual channel RAM, so basically motherboard, CPU, GPU and RAM, and see how much that will cost in a variety of developing countries and what we could get used for a similar budget. I'm assuming stuff like power supply, storage and case stay the same on those bills because those same components can be used in both. And if you ask me to add 3 more rows to the massive spreadsheet that I had to do for this video, I am going to jump out a window. So interestingly enough, a new Athlon 3000G is available floating somewhere around the $60 mark in almost every country I have checked. Two sticks of 4GB of RAM can usually be found floating around $40. Cheap RAM is surprisingly stable price-wise lately. And a motherboard for around $80. The motherboard is one of those things that varies the most because my criteria of the cheapest I can overclock means that sometimes an older B350 is still available and sometimes only a B450 is the only thing available. Now, averaging here is a bit hard because among regions there are variations on how taxes are applied to prices, and in many of these cases, a straight conversion to dollars is tricky, which is why it was hard to provide an exact conversion. Like, have you tried converting Argentinian pesos to dollars? You need years of training just to get this thing, which, believe me, I get the pain from experience. But, as a very general rule, this is useful for comparison and more importantly, what can you get on this territory's use for the same budget? Now if you're savvy and lucky, you can still find some really good deals. When I was researching places like Romania or South Africa, I was able to find pretty decent old i5 quad cores and a GPU like a 750 Ti, which is still pretty viable for low settings and 30fps for the similar price. In those cases, even if these old CPUs might have weaker per core performance, the two extra cores do help a lot, even if in practice they're going to start running into some of the performance issues of the Athlon somewhat soon. And then there's everyone else. During my research, a trend in a lot of countries emerged. First, I tried to find the cheapest GPU I could find that wasn't something like a GT710 and could reasonably play recently released games with some tweaks. This often takes the shape of a GTX 750 or 750 Ti or a GTX 660, which are all really good options. But this was not a super easy endeavor, and I had to dig hard, and sometimes some of these old GPUs are at prices that make like no sense whatsoever. But if you manage to find an appropriate price deal, then get the cheapest 8GB of RAM, you find that the options that are left for CPU and motherboards are not fantastic. The answer for most of these cases is usually a very old i5. These are far worse than some of the options from before. While this will do in a pinch, having one of these combined with a very limited used marketplace for upgrades makes me worried about hitting an under 30fps bottleneck in a lot of modern games, which to solve will require buying an entirely new motherboard. And those are the easy cases. The winners of this dubious competition among the very small group of countries I checked this time are Paraguay and Argentina, where in the case of Paraguay, the budget was only sufficient for something like a dual-core old i3, which is going to bottleneck real fast on modern stuff. And Argentina, where I search websites and Facebook marketplace to see very limited GPU options and even worse CPU options. Yeah, I don't think this is going to cut it for a lot of my test games, and it is not going to do very well for future upgrades either. Now, I need to be clear with something. I am using websites to compare provided by people like you who have contributed your local marketplace knowledge for this research. And I am sure if this was done by someone with very deep knowledge of where to look in their country, you can eventually dig something. But the more problematic the country, the less it becomes a matter of just searching on eBay, which can usually be the case for many North Americans and Western Europeans. When you search for used parts in developing countries and try to price match modern low-entry parts, you regrettably quickly end up with several bottleneck CPUs with anemic upgrade options. While general use new parts like the Athlon conserve their price relatively well among regions, can do reasonably well for a lot of games on their own, allow tremendous performance when paired with a dedicated GPU down the line, and have a very clear and active upgrade path. Look, a lot of people point to refurbished full office PCs as a starting point. Linus himself point to a video they did adding a GPU to an office PC they found for under $200. A full office PC with a 3rd generation i7. When you try to do a similar search in a Facebook marketplace, in somewhere like Argentina, you either find office PCs with i3s that are going to bottleneck very fast and get stuck in a place where it's difficult to upgrade, it's when the used market has such slim pickings, or in most cases like I have seen around, with a socket that is so old, I cannot really recommend it. Look, I'm all up for bargain hunting, and I have seen some fantastic computers for clever builders in developer countries squeezing the best out of old CPUs. But calling entry-level components that are widely worldwide available at low prices and allow people an easy entry-level point in gaming,
basically e-waste,
because the used part markets in your specific area of the world is good, is... it's a wide world out there. That's all I'm saying. But you know who doesn't forget the rest of the world exists? CuriosityStream. They feature documentaries from all around the world, featuring well researched and carefully made documentaries on anything from the race to find a vaccine for the current pandemic to freaking Mars. And the great thing about them is this deal I'm about to tell you. There's this little project we have been carefully carrying on our shoulders called Nebula. You see, me and a group of other creators frustrated by some of the difficulties of YouTube, which tends to narrow all of us creatively, decided to start our own streaming platform called Nebula. It is meant to host all of our content, including some snazzy originals like Theersu's Let's Play Outside series, where he tries some real-life animal builds, or Mustard's Underwater Aircraft Carriers, Imperial Japan's secret weapon, which... what? A submarine aircraft carrier? This existed? Here's the good news. Thanks to our partnership with CuriosityStream, you can get Nebula for free. If you sign up for CuriosityStream, with the link in the description, you get Nebula for free. CuriosityStream is already a fantastic deal at just $20 a year, but adding Nebula to it is just a steal. That's all the professional world-class documentaries you can watch, and the unleashed creativity of your favorite creators in one cheap package. Shut the front door. Using this link in the description gets you that and really helps out the channel. Thank you to CuriosityStream for their support and you for watching.